Yeah. So the question for my talk really to look at is, how do COVID vaccines link with or cause or be associated with urticaria? The first thing to say is that the last 2 years have really been unprecedented in the world of vaccinology. I really like to look at this world in data sight, because every couple of weeks you go there and you're just amazed by them. So most recently, I looked at it a few days ago, and you can see here that at the moment, 64% of the world's population have received at least one dose of a COVID-19 vaccine. That's over 11 billion doses. And at the height of the last couple of years, it's been about 40 million doses a day. Currently, we are in 50 million doses. Sadly, low-middle-income countries where I sit in South Africa, we have lagged behind the rest of the world. And South Africa, unfortunately, we haven't done the best in our effort. We only have managed to vaccinate 35% of the country, the lowest amongst BRICS nations. But we still, even with that relatively poor overall performances, we've still in our country administered more than 30 million doses of vaccine. This creates a remarkable database, actually, for the things that can occur, and particularly rare events that are often not picked up in the studies of vaccines. We are allowed to see this as we get into larger and larger amounts of people. But at the same time, in addition to us being so amazing in our global scientific effort to roll out vaccines so quickly and to get to all of the world's population, there's been a rise in misinformation related to vaccines. And you know, everyone here is linked on with social media and all of these things, but we've really seen lots of loud voices about concerns and misinformation about all kinds of things that vaccines may be causing or be harmful in different ways. So I think it's very important in that context to one, understand that in addition to this massive scale up of global efforts to examine, to roll out vaccines, has also been an upscaling globally of massive efforts to monitor and keep track very closely on the safety of vaccines. And so this really, and looking at urticaria in the context of a COVID vaccine, is also considering it as a adverse event following immunization. And so that's really what we'd look at in terms of side effects. And I think it's important to outline a couple of things when we think about this. Firstly, an adverse event following immunization is really related to a time sequence. So it's anything that happens. So if you develop urticaria in the week following your vaccine, well, there's a temporal relationship between you developing urticaria and you having a vaccine. So that is often how we start by looking at signals. However, the important thing to realize is that a temporal relationship doesn't necessarily mean a causal relationship. There might be other factors that have you been exposed to at that time, and it might be entirely coincidental. And certainly we've seen this in the context of the fact that we've just given so many vaccines to people. And given, if you give enough things to a large population of people, other things will be going on in the background. And then the other thing is that not every adverse event that you see is vaccine related. So how do we contextualize urticaria as an adverse event following immunization? Well, it doesn't even make it into, you know, the very common side effects. So if anything, it's occurring incredibly rarely. This is a list of the top 10 adverse events following COVID vaccines. And this is put out by our locally in South Africa, the regulatory body that monitors. So the equivalent of the FDA or the EMA guidance. And so I'm sure you might be familiar with some of these. And you can see here, the most common side effects following vaccine relates to what we call reactogenicity. So local site reactions around the injection site, things like headache, fatigue, some fever, or some other generally kind of a malaise. But that most of these quickly resolve in just a few days. There's, like MX showed that slide on the skin manifestations with COVID infection, we've also seen quite a broad spectrum of skin manifestations with COVID vaccines themselves. The first and by far the most common is just local swelling and erythema, redness around the site of vaccine. That's been by far the most common. But we definitely have seen both urticarial type rashes around the injection site, and then sometimes more generalized, and also very, very uncommonly, there have been case reports of actual angioedema, that's swelling in the deeper layers of the skin. There have also been some other kinds of rashes which have included sort of generalized diffuse rash. And again, that's actually the rash that we commonly see with viral infections. So we've seen some of that related to vaccines. And then various very rare events relate to some other immune phenomenon in the skin. But for those, you know, dermatologists on the call, it's important to note that they have been recognized. And it is the reason to note this is because if, for instance, you do with a chance have developed urticaria, there are things to look out for. And I'll show you in a slide down the line, things to be aware of that would prompt you maybe going to see your doctor. So what has been the features of this acute urticaria and angioedema? Well, firstly, to say it's still very, very rare. Our own data from our adenovirus Sosonke study, where we vaccinated almost close to 500,000 healthcare workers in South Africa, we saw urticaria and angioedema about 1 in 2,000 doses. So there was a little bit of it. The most common, as I mentioned, around the injection site or a little bit more generalized, it usually had a delayed onset. So unlike the more severe acute allergic reactions that can sometimes happen with any vaccine, those normally occur within the first 30 minutes or even maybe with the first 15 minutes, whereas these urticarial and angioedema features often come on delayed, so often 24 hours, even up to 10 days after the vaccine. They've got a predominance of female gender. And this is quite an interesting thing, that although it does appear to be more common in people with a prior history of other allergic diseases, let's say what we call atopic diseases like eczema, hay fever, asthma, actually what we saw in our study was that at least 40% of patients had no history and they got this acute urticaria. The good news, though, is almost all of it has been self-limiting, easily treated with some antihistamine or even a short course of steroid. And then usually we've seen it resolve very quickly. And this is very similar, in fact, to what we see with viral infection and urticaria. The vast majority of urticarias quickly resolve in this context. And the other thing about it relevant to multiple dosing, which we've now, you know, needed to do from an immunological and effective point of view, is that we usually see that this urticarial reaction will improve with the second dose. So it's usually worse the first dose, and then it will get better with the second dose. It does sometimes in a small percentage of patients recur. When should you be alarmed? In other words, when should you have a red flag and maybe see a doctor and take this a little bit further? Well, the first is if it's very severe. So if it does come very severely and it's not responding to your over-the-counter antihistamines. And then the other thing is if it goes on for a very long time. So normally most acute urticarias we see will resolve within a week. If it's starting to go on to 2 weeks, and you know, and right in the beginning, we mentioned the definition of chronic urticaria at 6 weeks. If it starts to go on very long, it is worth consulting your doctor and actually seeing whether this is something else. Then the other thing, and this is actually a general aspect of urticaria, urticarial lesions or wheals, they should resolve. And when they resolve, the skin should appear normal after that. It's almost like it's never been there. If the wheals or urticaria start leaving bruises, they show increased pain, or they're staying in the same place and not going down for a day or more, I think then it's worth considering and consulting a doctor. And then the other thing is if your hives are associated with other symptoms, whether it's worsening fever, joint pains. I mean, one of the things we've seen a lot in the South African context is actually people getting COVID very close to the same time that they've been vaccinated. And then they may develop full similar symptoms of COVID illness, plus or minus skin symptoms. And in that context, actually making the correct diagnosis of COVID was what is important in managing the patient. Then just a couple of other things that have been quite interesting is with particular vaccines. So those acute urticaria have been described with all the vaccines, more commonly with the mRNA vaccines. But interestingly, particularly with the Moderna vaccine, they've reported also again very rarely that patients develop what's called a large local reaction. So on the same site of the injection, and again, it would be a few days. Again, it's a delayed, so it doesn't come up immediately. But instead of just having a little bit of redness and some sore pain that goes down within 24 to 48 hours, some people develop really red, sometimes more painful rather than itchy, large local reactions. They and this is at the site, and you can see all these pictures showing this these reactions. And the good news again is that normally with just pain medicine, just mild analgesia, sometimes some antihistamine, they almost all resolve, but they can take quite a long time to resolve. So unlike the urticaria, which usually goes away within a week, these can take up to 11, 12 days to go down. And again, these two also get better on the next dose. What about chronic spontaneous urticaria? So urticaria lasting more than 6 weeks. Can you get this after a COVID vaccine? The answer is yes. We have seen this, but it is incredibly rare, fortunately. You know, again, I mentioned that we vaccinated 30 million people in South Africa. Our center in Cape Town is the only sort of UCARE center and specialist center in the country. And we now are writing up about six patients with this, where their chronic, where their urticaria has gone on to be chronic. It's mostly reported, if you look at the case reports and one or two case series, you'll see that it's mostly reported after mRNA, but again, it can occur after the adenovectors. It's often with a delayed onset, and the treatment and the management is exactly the same as other forms of chronic urticaria, and it will respond as well to anti-IgE therapy. Then I think the COVID, the COVAC-CU study and part of it has already been introduced. And these slides I've got and data I've got from MX early preliminary data. And predominantly, this is around studying all aspects of COVID disease, but also COVID vaccines in the context of chronic urticaria. And this preliminary look, which we've submitted as an abstract for EAACI, looked at 1,800 or 57 patients with chronic urticaria who'd gotten at least one dose of COVID vaccine. And you can see their demographics there and their backgrounds and treatments. Most of them, over 73%, were chronic spontaneous, but we also have some patients that have physical or inducible urticarias. Most patients had received two doses, but we even had patients in the cohort that had received booster doses or three doses or even four doses. You can see a good spectrum of different vaccines from across the world. The predominant vaccine in this cohort is the Pfizer mRNA vaccine. And then very few patients, less than 10% of patients, used pre-medication before their vaccine. And again, if you look at these common adverse events following reactions, they're very similar to that slide I showed earlier from our own data. So mostly people with chronic urticaria would get vaccines, just get the same side effects as everyone. What about exacerbations? Well, about 11%. So probably easier just to remember 1 in 10. 1 in 10 patients with chronic urticaria noted that they had some worsening of their symptoms following COVID-19 vaccines. And normally, if you look at the onset of these, again, it's predominantly delayed, right? So it doesn't occur right away. It occurs a few hours. There were five cases that reported anaphylaxis, more severe, small reactions. These are still under investigations, but there were no deaths. So the take-home messages from all of this is really that acute self-limiting urticaria can really occur following COVID-19 vaccination. Reactions usually improve with future dosing, and they can be relatively easily managed with over-the-counter medication in most instances. COVID vaccination is safe in patients with chronic urticaria or chronic inducible urticaria, and the overall rate of adverse events following immunization are not actually increased, but 10% or 1 in 10 of patients will have some worsening of symptoms with a COVID vaccine. And then very, very rarely, we will see some patients develop chronic urticaria from a COVID vaccine. And thank you. I just want to also end because I saw a question come up in the chat that I thought I would address, which is related to developing COVID, you know, testing. Once you think that the relationship is related to the vaccine, can I do specific testing? So what's interesting there is actually most of the time the testing is negative. If you take the vaccine, you do skin testing. So probably it's all of those mechanisms that Mick mentioned, all of those other innate stimulation and those immune changes that occur with stimulating the immune system is what's driving the development of these delayed, both acute urticarias and maybe in the rare instance, chronic urticaria, although we don't know that fully. It's not a situation where it's like a typical type 1 hypersensitivity allergy where you would find that you're allergic to a component of the vaccine or something like that. So in most instances with acute urticaria, I would not recommend, and we have not been doing skin testing because in the most instances it goes away on its own. And from the available data we have, the skin tests are predominantly negative. I hope that answers your question.